So superposition of space-time itself, of the geometry itself, is what distinguishes a semi-classical or classical theory of gravity being combined with quantum mechanics versus a quantum theory of gravity?
That's an interesting subtlety, actually, that Chiara and I like to discuss, and we did it in the paper that you mentioned, but over to
you. Yeah, I think there is a difference between preparing gravity itself in a superposition of different configurations. So if you think of a field, you can think of different configurations of the field or a superposition of geometries or whatnot. And the fact that gravity is quantum, so you can have some features of quantumness. So, for example, the ability to create entanglement is one feature. And the ability to be set into a state, which is a superposition of classical configurations, is yet another feature. And this test that we are discussing checks the former, so the fact that you can use this gravity as a channel to create entanglement, but it doesn't really prepare gravity in a quantum state that has the property of being in a superposition of different configurations. So it's more showing that gravity must be described by an object that isn't classical, which in jargon we call a Q number. So something that has the property that it when you consider it together with the classical features of gravity, such as some of the properties that you associate with gravity that are classical, if you consider these two things together, then they can be measured simultaneously by the same instrument, by the same measuring device. But this other Q number that mediates the entanglement, which is a non-classical aspect of gravity, doesn't necessarily have the property of being preparable in a quantum state. This is an extra property. So the experiment doesn't show that you can put gravity into a superposition, but it shows that it has a minimal set of properties that make it different from a classical object. And so it cannot be described by a classical field or by a classical set of numbers, which are all commuting with themselves in a way and therefore measurable at all by the same instrument. And I think this is a subtle difference.
It is a subtle difference.
Which is important to
indeed,
to
indeed. And I think maybe to put it this way as well, to add to what Chiara said, that this is a necessary property to talk about superpositions. If you didn't have this, then clearly you wouldn't even have superpositions of different spacetimes. But to create the superposition of spacetimes, you may need to do more. And then there is a question of whether this is really feasible to do or not. So it's interesting that our experiment, if successful, wouldn't necessarily tell you whether you could superpose these things. You would have to do another experiment to really try to prepare a superposition. The reason why I'm thinking is that it could simply be that these superpositions decohere. They're simply coupling so quickly to everything else in the universe, because the gravity basically has that feature that it sees everything, if you like, that in fact you cannot maintain the superposition for too long. And these are what you would call super selection rules in physics, that there are quantities that, even though they are quantum fundamentally, in this first sense that Chiara was describing, you still cannot utilize it fully. You're not allowed to make some superpositions, because they would get you into trouble with other things. So it's a very interesting thing. But I think certainly the thing to check, to test for beyond this proposal.
Yeah, so just to make it also a bit more clear, so I guess that the test for a superposition, if you want to check that something is in a superposition, you need to do an interference experiment directly on this entity. So for example, a photon, you can set it up in a way that performs an interference experiment with some device, a Mach-Zehnder interferometer or some kind of interferometry, so that you show that it has some wave-like properties, if you like. With gravity here, we are testing a lesser property, so that the photon has as well, which is this ability to create entanglement, to mediate quantum features between two other quantum objects. But it's not the full set of quantum properties. Really, if you really want to check that something has this property of being in a superposition, you need to set up an interference experiment. on the object itself. So in this case with gravity, but I think that's the thing that's very hard to do, and that's what it's actually practically impossible to do, because the quantum particles of gravity, the gravitons,
are not detectable
exactly, individually.
Exactly. If you trust Freeman Dyson's conclusion, I think you would say that the corresponding experiment with the graviton would never be done. Actually,
Well, with the photon is relatively accessible because it's been done many times.
Yes.
With gravity, this experiment, the interference experiment with gravitons, can't be done. And that's because of the difference in fundamental constants and the way they couple and all of that. So I think that's somehow how this experiment, this test that we proposed, somehow manages to bypass this problem by testing a different property, which still shows that gravity is quantum, but in a different way. It's an interesting fact.
Okay, I think the audience has been teased enough. So we'll get to the experiments in just a moment, the GIE experiments. First, I want you to spell out specifically what's meant when you both have been using this word mediate. Gravity mediates entanglement, or supposedly, or potentially. So that's something I'd like you to spell out. I'd also like you, when you start to talk about GIE, to distinguish it from Bose's initial experiments or proposals for experiments.
Yes.
And
yes,
maybe in your paper, you've outlined Page and Gelker and Cao. If you think those will take us off track, then you don't need to go into Page and Gelker or Cao. But if you think that that's useful as a stepping stone, then feel free to.
No, we can do that.
It's good, actually.
Yeah.
Floor is yours.
So shall I just... I can say a few things about this mediation generically. And actually, then you can even decide whether this fits in or not in the long story. I think these are all very,
it's very
beautiful
important
topics.
To talk
I think
about
so.
The mediation, yeah.
So physics is, like I said, all about fields, and actually, what's behind that is locality. So we believe that all interactions in physics take place at the same point. When two entities interact, they must be in the same point at the same time, and then they could affect the neighbors, and then the neighbors affect the neighbors, and then this propagates. So this was a main problem for Newton, by the way. His gravity was action at the distance, and he himself was extremely troubled by this. There are exchanges, letters with other scientists at that time, philosophers, where he acknowledges that no one in their right mind would think that planets can affect instantaneously one another. So the genius idea of Faraday, which, by the way, Maxwell formalized, and then Einstein took on board from the electrodynamics and applied to gravity, basically to introduce a field in between so that a planet only disturbs its neighborhood, creates gravity in the neighborhood, that gravity propagates like a wave at the speed of light, and then it affects other objects. When it reaches another object, it shakes the other objects locally. And that's basically your mediation. That's what we call a mediator. The field mediates the force, if you like, between these entities. Now, this was very important because you couldn't have conservation principles if you didn't have fields. That's what's interesting here. Let me give you a very simple example. When a planet is close to the sun, it moves faster. It has a higher kinetic energy. When it's further away, it has lower kinetic energy. Now imagine it's very close to the sun and it starts to move away, which means it loses energy. Where does the energy go now? And now you say, well, it takes 8 minutes for that signal to come from the Earth to the sun. But that doesn't sound logical to a physicist that for 8 minutes, energy is not conserved. It goes God knows where, and then suddenly after 8 minutes, sun picks up the momentum and says, oh, the Earth just lost some energy 8 minutes ago. I better speed up a bit. That would be very funny if it operated like that. With the field, there is absolutely no problem. The energy is stored in the local field, propagates to the sun, then the sun picks up that, and overall the field together with the two objects perfectly conserves energy, momentum, angular momentum, anything else. So that's the true value for this concept of the field. Now imagine quantum mechanically, and I think that's part of what Chiara and I, what our argument relies on fundamentally. In quantum mechanics, objects can be in two places at the same time. So now, in order to conserve anything, the field better understand how to respond simultaneously to the object in place one and the object in place two. So a classical field doesn't understand what that means. That's why, as Chiara was emphasizing, you really need these Q numbers to also describe the field, because the field must be able to respond simultaneously and conserve all of these entities in both places at the same time. And actually, that's key to our experiment. That propagates locally to the other particle. And in this picture, all of these principles are beautifully upheld. So I think a problem for any of these semi-classical theories is even bigger. They literally don't know how to strictly conserve these entities. They maybe have to do it stochastically on average, things like that, probabilistic conservation, but they can never do it exactly. And somehow to us, this looks like a huge price to pay. That's why it sounds kind of illogical that, that gravity is not quantum. But I think you wanted to...
Yeah, no, I wanted to just comment on the fact that I think more broadly speaking, the mediation requires there to be, so if you have two entities that, like in the experiment, that interact with each other, there's one way that can, as you were saying, it can happen that they interact directly, so they just talk to each other directly, or they don't talk to each other to each other directly, but they talk through a third element, to a third system. Now, this third system could be a field with all of the mathematical apparatus that describes a field, but it could also be a more general entity. So it doesn't have to be a field necessarily. But as you were saying, it's important to have the idea of the interaction happening not instantaneously directly between these two objects if they are space-like separated, so they are distant from each other in a sense. But there has to be a third system, which in this case is gravity, that mediates the interaction.
Indeed. Yeah.
And so in a way, this test that we are proposing does assume that the interaction is mediated in this way. I think it's a good assumption because, as Vlatko was saying, this is what most...
It parallels the rest of...
Yeah.
The rest
most
of physics.
Most theories of gravity that we've had that are meaningful, not just Einstein's general relativity, but other proposals as well, are mediated in this way. And this is a difference from Newton's gravitation theory, because in that case, Newton himself had the issues with the fact that there was this instantaneous action at a distance, which bothered him a lot. And that's because the interaction was not mediated.
Indeed. So and this is a nice point also to link back to what we said. This is yet another set of theories that we couldn't rule out. So we can't rule out we can rule out semi-classical descriptions, but out of the quantum descriptions, even the weird descriptions like non-local signals back from the future and things like that, none of that would be actually invalidated by our experiment.
Yeah, in all the classical descriptions that are not mediated.
That's it.
Are not tested by our experiment. So
yes.
They could still maybe be able to create entanglement, but they would do so in a non-local way.
Yes.
And we think that there are lots of strong reasons to just assume in the background knowledge the fact that we have, that the locality is satisfied and that we have a mediated interaction for gravity. But that's an important assumption. So it was nice that you asked the question.
As you know, on Theories of Everything, we delve into some of the most reality-spiraling concepts, from theoretical physics and consciousness to AI and emerging technologies. To stay informed in an ever-evolving landscape, I see The Economist as a wellspring of insightful analysis and in-depth reporting on the various topics we explore here and beyond. The Economist's commitment to rigorous journalism means you get a clear picture of the world's most significant developments, whether it's in scientific innovation or the shifting tectonic plates of global politics. The Economist provides comprehensive coverage that goes beyond the headlines. What sets The Economist apart is their ability to make complex issues accessible and engaging, much like we strive to do in this podcast. If you're passionate about expanding your knowledge and gaining a deeper understanding of the forces that shape our world, then I highly recommend subscribing to The Economist Economist. It's an investment into intellectual growth, one that you won't regret. As a listener of Toe, you get a special 20% off discount. Now you can enjoy The Economist and all it has to offer for less. Head over to their website, www.economist.com/toe, T-O-E, to get started. Thanks for tuning in, and now back to our explorations of the mysteries of the universe.